All right, good morning, and welcome to our presidential address. I'm Aurora Pryor, and I get the opportunity to introduce Liane Feldman, who is our current president of SAGES, who gets to then introduce our president of this meeting and our president from 2020 to 2021, Dr. Horacio Asbun. Hi, Liane.
Hi, Rory. It's like the pyramid of the pyramiding cascades of introductions, but thank you.
Thanks.
I have the true honor this morning of introducing Dr. Horacio Asbun, even though it's from pretty far away here in Montreal. And of course, I am very jealous of all of you there in Vegas, and watching it through the app has been really great, but it makes me really miss you all even more. And what an amazing meeting. When you're told that you will have the immense privilege of serving SAGES as president, one of the most daunting tasks, at least for me, is the idea of delivering an impactful, inspiring, and meaningful presidential address. Although Horacio, in these topsy-turvy times, has had a little extra time to prepare his words to us today, he's also had to adjust and adapt his presentation, and indeed all of his leadership goals, multiple times as we live through and adapt to this pandemic. As our first virtual president, and I certainly hope not to be the second, but it's not looking good so far, Horacio nonetheless was able to embody SAGES' vision to reimagine surgical care for a healthier world, and our SAGES' core mission to innovate, collaborate, and educate. And we were also fortunate that Horacio has proven to be one of the most resilient and adaptable leaders we could have. Horacio learned to be adaptable early on, and then he's adapted many times since then throughout his career, having trained and practiced in 4 different countries and 3 different states. Horacio grew up in La Paz, Bolivia, as the 5th child of 6. So in that situation, I do think you need to learn to go with the flow. Here he is with Dad Juan, Mom Odette, and 2 sisters and 3 brothers. See if you can pick him out. He's the one in the cute striped sweater, already having the SAGES logo imprinted on it. He knew what was to come. Dad Juan was a prominent surgeon in La Paz who also demonstrated strong values of social justice, founding a public hospital that's still running today and being a critical role model for Horacio. Horacio's talents were recognized early. After skipping preschool and kindergarten, the studious Horacio went right into first grade at the tender age of 4, shown here, already working away so diligently. And here he is around the time he entered medical school at the young age of 16 at the University of Chile in Santiago, definitely rocking that Jim Morrison look. Or maybe it was Peter Frampton, or for the Canadians of a certain age out there, maybe Gino Vannelli. 2 critical events happened to Horacio in medical school, here described not in order of importance, but in chronological order. The first is a professional milestone. During medical school, Horacio would return home to La Paz on vacation, and instead of actually taking vacation, would work in his father's hospital. The fellows would sneak him into the operating room, and after second assisting on 30 appendectomies, they handed him the keys. So here he is at age 19, performing his first appendectomy skin to skin. For all the kids out there, this was called an open appendectomy. It's of historic interest. Of course, Horacio never used such a big incision again. No doubt that this very early experience paid off in Horacio becoming widely renowned for his technical mastery, getting in those 10,000 hours early. The second critical event was related to his love of skiing as he met Liu, the other love of his life, on the ski hills in Chile just before finishing medical school. Obviously, his excellent form, and despite the lack of wearing a helmet, he won her over. With Horacio having that decisive surgical personality, they were married a short time later, just around medical school graduation back in 1983. After med school, Horacio spent a couple of years in Barcelona and in surgical oncology fellowship at UC San Diego. Then he began his general surgery residency at Kern Medical Center in Bakersfield, California in 1986. During residency, sons Dominic and Derek were born, here shown with a very happy dad. In 1991, he went to Leahy Clinic for fellowship in GI and HPB surgery. The family then went back to Bolivia for a couple of years before settling in the Bay Area. He eventually took a private practice position, which provided needed stability for the family, who by this point had moved almost every year. In 2008, he was recruited to Mayo Clinic, Florida, as chair of general surgery and director of the HPB program, before moving to his current position in Miami as chief of HPB surgery at the Miami Cancer Institute in 2019. It was actually during residency that Horacio developed his passion for laparoscopic surgery. Having heard about the first lap colies being performed by Drs. Eddie Joe Reddick and Douglas Olson, in 1989, as a resident, he somehow managed to arrange a month-long elective with them in Nashville, and then became a proctor in their famous weekend courses, manning one of the pick stations and teaching famous surgeons from all over North America about this new technique. It was actually Dr. Reddick who told Horacio to join SAGES because it was a cool society with lots of innovators. And Horacio has been a SAGES member since 1991, so that's quite the lineage. It's likely that these experiences encouraged Horacio to become an innovator and educator himself. He worked his way up to laparoscopic Whipples by first practicing on some very easy splenectomy cases. Horacio is known as a master technician in pancreatic surgery, truly one of the world's best, and he shares his passion so generously, traveling the world to teach, mentoring scores of trainees, making close friends all over the world. He has published close to 200 papers and book chapters and 5 books, and presented over 100 peer-reviewed videos. He's given more than 650 presentations and courses on 6 continents, which is pretty astounding. But of course, of all his trips he's made, I'm sure this trip to Montreal, down in the lower right, was probably one of his favorites. Horacio is passionate about global surgical issues. He co-founded Medical Training Worldwide, a nonprofit organization dedicated to teaching current practices in surgery, anesthesia, and medicine in developing countries. He was also a founding board member of the G4 Alliance, dedicated to increasing safety in surgical and anesthesia care as a global political priority. And this is how you know you have an international reputation: when you were in the OR in Russia, watching yourself on TV. So how did Horacio climb to the top of SAGES? His first committee was Educational Resources, which he later chaired. He brought his passion and knowledge of international surgery to his transformative work as chair of the Global Affairs Committee. He's been on the board since 2006. He was the program chair for the 2017 meeting with my colleague, Dr. Vassiliou, here in Montreal, and served as vice president and then president. I don't think Horacio ever imagined he would be SAGES' first virtual president, but he handled that with grace and made sure we stayed on track through virtual committee meetings, virtual retreats, virtual board meetings, and here's a virtual dinner with our exec. In describing Horacio, the exec consistently mentioned his energy, his generosity, and of course, his international work. So what does Horacio do to keep up his incredible energy? He loves to stay fit, and he and Liu are aficionados of Bikram yoga. But Horacio doesn't need a studio to practice yoga. Here he's seen posing at the Parthenon, Pisa, Central Park, Milan, Bolivia, and the pyramids, as well as at the beach. Horacio likes adventure. He's taken up some extreme sports like parachuting, paragliding, diving, skiing or piste. You don't have to bother reading those signs. And swimming, it looks like swimming off the top of skyscrapers, which sounds pretty dangerous. Like most surgeons, Horacio likes to take control, and this seems to extend to driving, whereas visiting, no matter what the vehicle is, including rickshaws, go-karts, at least wearing a helmet, taxis in the Philippines, or even oxen at the Taj Mahal. Horacio and Liu also love to travel together. They look pretty great doing it wherever they are, all over the world, whether in Rome, on the salt flats in Bolivia, in Russia, or anywhere else. They also all love traveling together with Derek and Dominic on active trips, of course, where they bike, they boat, they hike, they swim, they ride camels. and they all still love to ski together. Even when they're scattered all over the place, they keep in touch, like all families do, by sending pictures of themselves jumping. I think it was started off by Derek in Cape Town, but then everyone else got in the game in DC, in California, and in Chile. But here they are, a bit more relaxed on vacation in Greece. Horacio is so proud of his family, and happily everyone is a little less scattered, with son Derek settled in Manhattan after a career as a professional rugby player, followed by degrees at Oxford and Cape Town, and with son Dominic now completing his own surgical training and about to join Horacio as a surgeon at the Miami Cancer Institute, and of course as an active SAGES member. So pretty amazing to have a third generation of talented Asbun surgeons. Congratulations, Horacio, on leading SAGES through some very tricky and challenging times, and we look forward to hearing your presentation this morning.
Liane, thank you very much for that. Really, when you see your life like this, you understand how blessed you have been. Thank you, Liane. What a year this has been. These are unusual times. But my question to you is, how unusual are they? If we go back and try to see if other pandemics have happened, we know of several. However, early in the pandemic, in last year, I went to see how many people had to go through this. In the 1350s, 50 million deaths, that was 60% of Europe's population. The Great Plague of London killed 20% of its population and was followed immediately by the Great Fire of London. Cholera, 150 years of recurrent pandemics of cholera. In less than a year, 360,000 deaths only within three countries. In 1918, this was the last one before COVID, we already heard about the Spanish flu, 50 million deaths. 1.1 million deaths on the Asian flu in 1957. And the AIDS epidemic, not a pandemic, has killed 35 million people. Then if we keep the last three, and we assume a person that was born in 1910, by 70 years old, that person would have gone through the three pandemics, through World War I, through Great Depression, through World War II, through the Korean War, and through Vietnam War. That kept me thinking. The reality was that in April of 2020, I thought, it seems that I had it good until now. We had not experienced, at least in my lifetime, something like that so obvious in our faces. Then I thought, okay, how are we going to survive this? And I tried to look for signs of hope in general, as we all were scared. And then I saw what was happening. An opera singer singing from his window in Paris, a ballet dancer, a child in the middle of Times Square, people in Toronto doing yoga, people graduating with robots because they want to be present there, a concert in one of my favorite venues, the Palau of the Music Catalana in Barcelona, where the musicians still want to perform. And this was very touching. In a hospital in Bronx, a mother that had to deliver its baby 2 months earlier because she had COVID, and the staff wanted to reunite them. Then I thought, okay, I'm gonna have to be leading this society. How can I find resilience? Resilience is the ability to thrive in spite of adversity. The concept of resilience has been studied extensively, specifically on how humans respond to stressors. And it is clear that everyone experiences traumatic events, or almost everyone. But people respond in various ways. And as you see these heroic histories, you realize that humans are genetically wired to focus on negative emotions and memories. And not everybody responds immediately with a positive response. However, resilient people pay attention to the positive ones. Then I thought, okay, I'm facing adversity. The first thing I had to do was to embrace it. I had a responsibility. I thought, okay, when adversity knocks, define the problem and try to acknowledge it. It's not about not getting knocked down. It's, of course, we all know how we're gonna stand up. Then, I don't know where I found strength, but I decided to do this. However, the future can be paralyzing when you don't know the outcome, and I didn't know the outcome. I start thinking, how do we best support our members? How do we keep SAGES productive? How do we remain financially sustainable? How do I keep leaders engaged? How do I lead in the world of physical isolation? And then the first thing you do is to utilize your existing resources and strengths, right? I don't know what's gonna happen. Let's see what we count. And that's when it hit me. Everything is gonna be okay. Why? Because I am dealing with a group of people that are called SAGES. And as Joe Bieske clearly stated at the Gerald Marx lecture in 2016, SAGES is a self-selected group of people that see opportunity where others see obstacles. That was not 2020. That was 2016. That was a visionary statement that truly helped me understand it's not me, it's us. And the us are so much bigger than me that we will get things done. And that's what happened. My executive committee was superb. They served not only as people that supported me through this, but people that mentor me by the way how they were acting. Their energy, passion, enthusiasm, and imagination really pushed SAGES through this period. It wasn't me. I was just taking a significant part of the credit. And of course, the BS team and Sally. You always hear about thanking Sally. When you become a president, you know why. Because that is crucial for all of us to be able to work together. Then in terms of leveraging our existing resources, Rory had already started putting a rapid response team, and I'm not going to repeat all of this because you had the opportunity to see it yesterday on the keynote speech that brilliantly performed Pat and John. But definitely, we did a significant amount of things. And then there were other things that we didn't know how to do. We didn't have enough resources. And on those cases, we had to be creative, we had to be bold, we needed to change things, and at the same time realize that maybe some of those changes are going to solve historical challenges that we had. And that's all what happened. We had a huge impact, as it was shown in yesterday's keynote speech. We were proactive, publishing a variety of things. We collaborated with other societies. We realized that collaboration, not isolation, would get us there. We saw firsthand how that created greatness. And I hope that will be one of the good legacies of this adversity. And I repeat that, collaboration, not isolation. And I don't mean just about us, sages, but with other societies and with the world. This pandemic has shown us we are all equal. Education didn't stop, in fact, flourished. Innovation, maybe one of the great innovation years in the last decade that we have had under the leadership of our executive committee. How did we do this? Believe it or not, Zoom, more Zoom. We got bored of Zoom. We decided, what do we do? We brought our families, sometimes our pets, to try to distract ourselves after the meetings. We were Zooming out, as we said. And then we found a way of getting a little bit more funny and distracted. We use humor because humor really helps you not so much to diffuse the problem, but is a powerful tool to reframe the narrative of your situation. And it doesn't discredit the pain that may be in it, but it is about pulling upon positive emotions when you need them the most. And yes, I have to acknowledge, we still miss those times where we saw our leaders driving the boat in person, but we were able to pivot and do what we needed to do. Then I would like to now spend some time talking about some of the ups and downs I have experienced in my life. Obviously, I won't talk about everything, but I do that. Before I do that, I will frame first with this 1.5-minute video.
Marcus Aurelius once said, "It's not death that we should fear. We should fear never beginning to live." When we die, our lifeline does this. When we're alive, our lifeline does this. Notice how that connects with our real experience of life. Life is full of ups and downs. It means you're alive. Twists and turns, love and loss, happiness and sadness, success and failure. We experience extreme highs, peaks and summits. We cry inside a little, experience a few moments where we wanted to stop and hope it's all over, but it just keeps going. We somehow think that success is linear, an upward line. There is literally no case study for that. Everyone we admire has ups and downs. Don't judge the moment. Don't try to hang on because it will keep pushing you forward. We cannot avoid the ups and downs, but we can change the way we see them. Because as Wayne Dyer said, when we change the way we look at things, the things we look at change.
When we change the way we look at things, the things we look change. As Liane said, I was born in La Paz, Bolivia, beautiful city. I had initially a dreamt childhood. You saw that. I love that bow tie. I had a beautiful yard where I experienced what nature meant, and that marked for the rest of my life my relationship with nature. This is an actual tree where I spent hours hiding, where everybody was looking for me, and I had a lot of fun in that tree. These were my classmates from high school, elementary school and high school. It was a small number of people in my class. They were the base of my foundation of relating to other people, of ethics, of morals, and I still remember them today. My father, what a man. He was an extremely well-known physician, great technical surgeon, but above all, he loved people. He was physician of presidents, but also he took us to jail, to the jail outside the city to attend jailmates. He built a hospital for poor people. He showed me so much about what you could do for your human fellows. As an example, once he passed away, I was going through his things, and he was a very meticulous guy, and I found this nasal cannula. There was a used nasal cannula. And I thought, my dad putting this on his important stuff? What is this? And there was a little envelope. I opened the envelope, and the envelope was from the ambassador of the Pope, saying that John Paul II, to which my father attended him as a physician, had used this nasal cannula. I held it, I said, oh my God, I better get some of these cells for genetic testing. My mother, again, an amazing person. She came from a very notorious family, but her father's gambling destroyed that. And she couldn't even finish high school. My father was the first one finishing college in his family. My mom didn't finish high school. However, she was the most educated, one of the most educated persons I have met. And ironically, she infused in me over and over and over that education is much more important and rewarding than having lots of money. She, above all, show me that being there for the ones you love is the most important thing. She supported my father in ways that I did not realize until after she was long gone and she didn't have taken any credit for it. Above all, she made me feel she was there for me every day of my life. That is what made me feel comfortable. She taught me about having real fun and about the fact that life is full of joy. My dad was work, principles, ethics. My mom followed that. But when my dad wasn't seeing, wasn't watching, she showed me how to have joy in life. All of this, though, at some moment, adversity hits. This is my brother, who was studying medicine in Oxford, and at 22 years old, he passed away. That impacted me. I would like to say that I got something out of that adversity, and most likely I did, as you will hear, but those memories don't go away, and I saw my parents suffer through it. However, up to that point, I was not going to be a physician. I said, my dad works too hard. And after he passed away, he was the only physician in the family I started considering, and I became a doctor. As a surgeon, I'm being blessed. You can see in the center picture, I'm teaching my father how to do laparoscopic cholecystectomies in 1990, when he's 68 years old. And on the right, on the other picture of the corner, I'm doing surgeries with him. He's 83 years old, and I'm operating my best friend from elementary school, and the person in the back is my brother-in-law, all in the family. Then I went to the University of Chile, where I had a fantastic time. I met Liu, and once I finished my university, I went to the Hospital Santa Cruz Sao Paulo in Barcelona, Spain. Beautiful building. I had a lot of fun, but above all, I had this gentleman, Jorge Puig Lacalle. He used to come to the States many times. He was well known here. And one day he called me to his office on the first year of training, and he told me if I felt that I was doing enough, if I felt that I could accomplish what I want to accomplish in Spain. At that time, I was 23 years old, 24 years old. And then he told me, you need to go to the United States. That's going to be the only country in the world where you really are going to be able to develop your full potential. At the time, as a foreign resident in Spain, I was a little bit of a second-class citizen because the residents in Spain got the first choice for doing the cases. Therefore, I would probably not be able to do too many cases. I came to the United States, and at the time, a period, I think, of 4 or 5 years, you had to give the visa qualifying examination. It was interesting because there was a belief that everybody knew about this, and once you pass it, you'll be accepted into residency training. But interestingly enough, it was a test that only was to obtain a visa. It was felt that the test was much more difficult than any of the other American boards, and they said the test itself had over 1,000 items and 40 seconds per question. And the goal was to have a very low pass rate. In that way, as they said, it would be a screening function. But 10%, less than 10% of a pass rate was not right. In fact, at the time that I took the examination, if you take the two days at a time, there were only 4.8% of the people that passed. And that's, I passed not because probably I was better than the others, but because I had the means to be able to sit and study for the test 6 days a week for 5 months. That's the reason why I passed. I passed the test, but the low pass rate was unfair. And a group of foreigners sued the board and won, and they changed to this intermediary test that many of you don't even know, that it was called FMGEM. And they felt really good because they increased the pass rate to 23%. A few years later, this test also went away, and now foreign graduates need to be taken just the regular boards. I was so happy when I received that I passed the test. There was a significant time and effort that required passion and perseverance for my long-term goals at that time, and that is what is called grit. At the time, I didn't know. But also, I had the advantage, as I said, to have the support to be able to study. Then I thought I was in. I sent 300 applications. Remember, no internet. 300 envelopes and letters. I received 8 responses. No interviews. Now I'm married. What do I do? I don't have a job. I went back to Spain. And there, again, Push La Calle told me you should go back to the United States. And now I have the United States in my mind. I came to UCSD to do research at a time where the researchers were told, as I was, you won't get into residency training because at this point foreigners cannot come in into surgical training. We have too many local candidates. And then I applied and matched at Kern Medical Center in Bakersfield. This was an associated program to the University of California, and it was a small program. I had recommendations that, is that all what you could get? Another adversity, now I'm in a small program, it's not gonna be good. But what appeared to be a disadvantage, a small program, became an asset for my professional future. Changed the way how I saw things. And again, now I'll honor Dr. Jack Block. Dr. Jack Block taught us about teamwork. We were a small group of residents, extremely clinically busy. One of the residents, Russell Downies, flew last night just to be today sitting in this auditorium, as a sign of respect to Jack Block and our attendings. Dr. Block saw things on us that we didn't see ourselves. And in fact, in one of his evaluations, he said he needs some sort of elective experience in the next half a year to broaden his surgical horizons. He felt he needs to get out of here and see more. Thanks to that, I went to Mayo Clinic. One more time, Mayo Clinic, fantastic, but I'm a foreigner. I couldn't do clinical work at Mayo Clinic in Rochester. They accepted me as an observer for a month. Now I'm a fourth-year resident, at the beginning of my fourth year. What do? I observed. I took notes, and more notes, and more notes, and detailed notes. When I was reviewing this, I said, oh my God, I was crazy. Use the back of the fingertip, brackets, the nail, or lateral side of the finger to pass the tie around the tip of the clamp. Was I bored watching or what? This, though, it did teach me about observers. I felt invisible in front of these giants, but I didn't take it personal. I was encouraged, and at the same time, it taught me how I wanted to treat my observers if one day I would have observers. And I have been very fortunate to have over 150 observers in the last 10 years at Mayo and the last 3 years at my new place. And those observers that I treated well have benefited me so much. Imagine 150 people from 23 countries telling you how they do it. I learned so much. My surgical technique has improved significantly just because my observers were not invisible as I was at Mayo Clinic. Then, continuing in my residency training, I took advantage of what he had said, what Dr. Block had said, that I needed to do an external rotation. One of my other co-residents in Kern Medical Center, with whom I had done, I put a laparoscope on a, when we had a hernia that was reduced, we used to put a laparoscope in to see if the intestine was alive, and we both like laparoscopy. He calls me and tells me there are two guys that are doing cholecystectomies. I went to Dr. Block and I asked him for a second elective rotation. I don't know how he gave it to me. I had already done one less than a year ago. He did, and as you heard, I went to Reddick and Olson, and I was very fortunate with that. I started teaching. In fact, when I came back, I taught my attendings and all my residents, and we had a lot of fun with this. But residency was not all rosy. I had a 50% cut, pyramidal cut at the time, after 2 years. And I made the cut, but then I couldn't go to third year. Why? Again, because I was from a foreign medical school. The California license didn't allow me because they asked for signature of all my clinical rotations by the attending that had the clinical rotation. I had 32, but I got, I think, 29. I had 31, but I got 29. Two attendings had not signed. They didn't accept it. I could have faked the signature. Why didn't, I don't know. I send it back, ask the dean. The dean signed them. Bring it back. They didn't accept it. I knock at the door of Dr. Block and said, I'm sorry, I'm not going to be able to be a third year and I cannot get a license. He took a phone call, wrote a letter, something that I was fighting for around 6 months. He got in less than 5 minutes. Also, as you have heard yesterday, we all deal with racism. I'm not going to dwell on it. And I am very fortunate because of what my mom said. Education trumps everything else. And I have multiple examples to give you. But as a funny story, I'm going to give you one at an outside rotation with a vascular surgeon who initially, like I had experienced it before, didn't like me just because of it. But I don't take it personally. And he finally, because what I did is just work hard. The large majority of them, they are going to see you and they're going to be able to accept you, and it's over. This guy did that, but did it in a way that surprised me. One day I was scrubbing and trying to tell me, I accept you. He said, Horace, I just came to the conclusion that you are like one other friend I have. You are a white person that just happens to speak Spanish and has to live fighting with the stigma of not being a Mexican. When he told me that, I thought, good. He now is accepting me on his circle. But I looked at him, and rather than being mad, I was sad, because I realized this is the way he was educated. He was not exposed to any other thing. I didn't take it personal. All of this wraps in to what John Mellinger said yesterday. Does it exist? Of course it does. How bad it is? It's bad. Will it be solved? I don't know. But I do feel that we're finally making some real progress. Word of caution, though. Don't use its existence to get back at them and to do to them what they did to you. Because if not, you're going to become one of those people that makes this statement that I have heard. I hate people that hate. John put it so beautifully. Around a few months ago, I was talking to him on the phone, and we were talking about this subject. And you know, John is a mentor. John Wise, is judgment helps you every day. And he said, well, I had African-American colleagues. The relationship was not the closest. Getting around them and hearing their stories put me in a place of humility and teachability. What he's talking about there is what Mandela did to solve the problem when he took over after decades in jail. He didn't get back. He just did teachability. I opened my ears to things that otherwise I would have never heard. That is what's going to solve the problem in general. Humility and teachability. Being open to the concept that we are all equal. After my training, I went to Lehi Clinic. Great year. I worked with John Brash, Ricardo Rossi. I learned a lot. I did a lot of laparoscopic surgery in other areas with difficulty because they were isolated. But eventually, they offered me a job. I was so happy. I signed a contract, 31 years old, on top of the world. We were going to create what at that time was going to be the first mini-invasive surgery department, a division. Contract didn't last. They resigned it. They rescinded in less than 3 months because they said, sorry, we thought we were going to be able to change your visa, but we can't. After being on top of the world, talk about ups and downs. I had no job. All the other job offers that I had plenty had filled up, and I didn't know what I was going to do. I realized then a very good lesson on ego. It doesn't matter how good you are. The moment you believe you are better than what you are, the downfall looms around the corner. That I have seen in incredibly skilled, talented surgeons through the last 3 decades of my life. It is inherent to what we do, there's no question. And it is imperative for a surgeon to maintain a balanced blend between confidence and humility. On failure, and why do I say failure? I went back to Bolivia. I didn't have money. I had debt. But I realized that some failure is inevitable. I love this quote from J.K. Rowling. It is impossible to live without failing at something unless you live so cautiously that you might as well not have lived at all, in which case you failed by default. As I said, I went back to Bolivia. I was in debt. At the beginning, I had to have my family to live with my parents. It was a major setback in MIS. Imagine 1991, 1992, you live when we were all blooming. I was in the middle, I was in the top. All of a sudden, I didn't have access to equipment. And it was a very bad cultural shock because I had left when I was 16 years old. Now I come with a completely way of doing the work, and I was frustrated. My father said, you're going to have to go back to the States because you hit the top. You're going to be really successful, but not on the way that I have been successful. That was tough. Nevertheless, again, if you change the way how you see things, those 2 years were incredibly useful. I got to operate with my father, a life's gift. I had my children born with my parents, and this paid off for later. They were able to experience who my parents were. And that may have played a very important role in what Liane already said, Asbun 3.0. I came back to the United States thanks to this lady, Pauline Velez. She was a year older than me, but she was the chief at the VA. And at that time, I had interviewed at UC Davis. And in UC Davis, they interview around 10 people over there. I want you to see what we would think today if somebody writes this. Horacio Asbun is highly qualified in endoscopy and laparoscopy and shows interest in an academic career. His major problem is that he is a foreign medical graduate. But if unable to recruit other candidates, he would be an excellent choice. At that time, UC Davis, Pauline Velez said to UC Davis, even if you don't hire him, I want him. I'm gonna put him on the county hospital and part-time at the VA, and she hired me. Before coming back, I had been 2 years in Bolivia. My family was okay, and I told Pauline, I'm not coming back unless you promise me there are gonna be no problems with visa. I cannot deal with this anymore. Then she said, fine, I promise you we're gonna get a green card, but you need to come on an H-1. However, when she tried to do that, the VA told her, why are we gonna be doing this? If we do this, he can leave. In their own words, he will be free to work for any other employer. Basically, keep him on the H-1 for several years until we don't want him or whatever. Wasn't I at the country of the free? But by then, I had been smarter. And I realized, if they don't change my visa, I'm leaving tomorrow. And they did, thanks to Pauline Velez. Fast forward, I'm in practice. Life's ups and downs. And one of my most dearest person in my life. She passed in an airplane on my lap. That was impactful for me. And I realized death. We should not be afraid of it, because it will happen to all of us. Nobody in this auditorium is gonna get off this life alive. Then I thought the same thing, I need to embrace it. And what should I do is I have to put the energy on things that I can control. In that way, whenever it's gonna be happening, I'm ready. And more of that later. I finished then my academic career at UC Davis and the VA for 4 or 5 years. And then I moved to private practice because, as Liane said, my family had been uprooted several times, and I gave up academics. I thought, you know, I would really like to stay, but my family's first. And again, I thought I was not going to do academics, but in private practice is where I developed the first laparoscopic Whipple, where I did my first laparoscopic right hepatectomy, and I had a great time with the people working, and I learned a lot from them. Again, changing the way how you see things. And then I was recruited by Mayo Clinic, fantastic place to work. Great friends. I have two of my best friends from Mayo Clinic sitting on the front row. I did great cases, and I had a team that was incredible. Surgical technician that knew everything what I did. By the time I was leaving Mayo Clinic after 10 years, the farewells made me feel on top of the world again. I told Liu, it's amazing. One of the farewells was a 45-minute video about people saying how grateful they were that I was there and what my presence had impacted their lives. I told Liu, it's amazing that I know this. A lot of people that dies, they don't even know. I didn't even know. You just do your work every day. Little did I know what I was saying. Life had other plans for me. I was recruited to Miami Cancer Institute. I made them wait a year to decide because, again, I was making a big transition. And the first week that I arrived there, I loved to exercise, and I was testing a new gym. I did 3 classes. This is July 4th, 2018. In the morning, this is the 3rd class, I'm doing aerial yoga. Again, I'm feeling on top of the world. And then the next day, I start going to my new job. And when I'm going up and down the stairs, I'm feeling dizzy. To make a long history short, I require emergency 5 coronary bypasses. Had to fly back to Mayo Clinic, where I had left less than 2 weeks before, to have my chest open. I wanna thank Raul Rosenthal, because thanks to him moving fast, probably he prevented an AMI on me. Again now, going back to death, and dying. Remember I told you, try to be ready. I realized then that I had done enough things that made me love being alive, that I made a positive difference thanks to all of those farewells in someone's life, that I made this a better place, and that someone cared and loved me. But all of this, not just because of me, but because of everybody that surrounds you. How did I recover? It was never more obvious to me that who I was because of the people around me. I recovered because of them. Dominic, since he was a small kid, he wanted to be a doctor. He stole my glasses and the beeper, and he used to say, "I'm a surgeon." He has given me so much pleasure in life by doing what he has done that I cannot even stop telling you. But during my recovery, I had had a very hard recovery. I couldn't do surgical knots for a variety of reasons that I'm not going to expand. He was there making sure that my surgical skills come back. He forced me to do knots. You can see there a text on June 10th saying knots. January 17, January 18, January 19, January 21. At some point I say, "You butthead, it's past midnight, I'm in bed." He said, "Okay, I forgive you for today, but tomorrow I won't." And he starts putting in other languages, Italian, English. That's what I had to send him for him to stop sending me the text. Derek. I learned about the power of sports in college thanks to Derek. I learned about imaging, mental preparedness. I applied to surgery. He again gave me so much satisfaction. But he was my physical coach, and I'm not joking. He taught me how in sports they recover after an injury, how I had to be patient and not a surgeon. He flew every weekend from New York to come and help me recover when I was barely walking at the beginning. And he gave me pleasure. In Oxford, I went to Twickenham, the largest rugby venue in the world, to see him play when he was playing for Oxford against Cambridge. He took me to the Oxford-Cambridge Club. This is the guy from La Paz, Bolivia. Now I'm in the Oxford-Cambridge Club. He became the rugby, he wear a blue that's like the green jacket on Augusta for the ones that play in Twickenham against Cambridge. And he became an American Player of the Year for the Oxford team. Dominic and Derek, thank you for the balance and equilibrium you have given my life. And above all, thank you for allowing me to fulfill one of the most precious gifts life can give you, and that's being a father. With all the success I have accomplished, being a father is the one that I cherish the most. And now, since that's the achievement I cherish the most, there is someone else to whom I cannot express in words my gratitude, and that's Liu. Liu is the one that made it possible, because she knew how important it was for me to be a good father, and she made it possible. She was not only instrumental on making it possible, but she herself is the best mother I could have ever asked for Dominic and Derek. Besides that, she was there and she has been there over the last several decades when the going was uphill. My wife of 37 years was there jokingly trying to tell me how could I be better or not, and always with humor. When I say this, though, I want to go back to the ups and downs in life, and I don't want to portray that every relationship is perfect. Relationships are hard and have ups and downs, and this could be among the most difficult adversities we face. In many instances, we don't know what to do. And on those instances are the ones that is not so much about doing the right or wrong thing. It's about doing the loving thing. Going forward now at Miami Cancer Institute, I have to thank Mike Zinner and Leonard Kalman because they held my job and supported me fully through those times. Dr. Zinner was advertised as a gentleman and as a solid person that would support you as a mentor, and he has been that. And my team, they look serious. This was last week. They look without a mask, and this is how they really look. This is my intimate team. Of course, we have the larger team, but if it wouldn't be because of Ramon Jimenez, I couldn't do everything I do because he covered for me. My PAs, nurses, and fellows are there, and also my operative staff. On Sage's mentors that I have to thank. I would remiss to not to mention them. However, I didn't have a single mentor. I don't have a single Sage's mentor. But I had several that taught me age is not a limitation, that you need to put attention to people even if they are nobody and give them opportunity. Do not to forget that patients are first and you shouldn't be submerged only on the society. That mentoring is extremely important. Take and make sure you have a plan B. Be as confident in your societal work as you are in the operating room. Have extraordinary courage when you are facing certain steps and certain things in your life. Be a gentleman and a scholar. Be a friend and always have your back. You heard him. It's interesting what he said before is something that I remember of him 5 years ago. Don't worry about taking credit. Just do the thing. Credit will come back later. To going through adversity when you are a president-elect and doing it quietly and overcoming it without people knowing. Through having a big ego, but knowing exactly when to be humble and always being a friend. To being a president and knowing you can have fun still being a president and make sure your executive committee also has fun through it. And to bite much more than what you can chew, but do it all in a time record. Let me leave you with a couple of final thoughts. We commonly hear that you cannot progress in Sage's leadership unless you have a mentor. I progress, and I didn't do that, or at least I don't think that I did that because I'm necessarily better than others. I think the success was because I frequently ask myself, am I missing opportunities as life unfolds in front of me? And in reality, I know that opportunity lies in adversity. And whether or not it is clear to you, life unfolds as it should. And with all its ups and downs, life is still beautiful. Thank you very much.
Wow. That was amazing, Horacio. Really a nice capstone on your year and really showing us you had the background and the strength to deal with the adversity that we had and really led Sages through one of the hardest years in our history. So one more round of applause for all you did for us. So I have the honor on bestowing you your plaque to congratulate you for this amazing year and for your great leadership and your legacy to Sages.
Thank you very much.